Almighty God, may the words of my mouth and the meditation of our hearts be acceptable in your sight, O Lord, our strength and our Redeemer. Amen. Kindly sit, please. This morning I want us all to reflect on a very pointed line from the gospel lesson for today. That line in St. Mark's Gospel, chapter 7, and verse 29. But who do you say that I am? Who do you say that I am? I'm sure we're all familiar with this particular passage where Jesus enters the village of Caesarea Philippi and asks his disciples, who do people say that I am? And all of a sudden, everyone has an answer. But then when he asks them a more intimate question, who do you say that I am? One can imagine there must have been a deafening silence. And then only one person speaks up. Peter speaks up and says, you are the Messiah. And here is where Mark differs from Matthew. Because in St. Matthew's Gospel, when this particular passage comes up, straight away Jesus confers on Peter the keys to the kingdom of heaven. Flesh and blood has not revealed this to you. Peter, you are now the rock. And on this rock I will build my church, and to you I'll give the keys to the kingdom of heaven. But Mark doesn't see it in that way. Because Mark then goes on to point out that inasmuch as Peter called Jesus the Messiah, how he understood him to be the Messiah was not the way Jesus wanted him to understand him to be the Messiah. Because very shortly after, once Jesus talks about his death and suffering, clearly that is not the Messiah that Peter knew. And so we're told that Peter called him aside and rebuked him. What kind of nonsense you're talking? We now call you the Messiah. We big you up. And all of a sudden you with this thing about you're going to die and all this kind of thing. Because Peter didn't truly understand what the Messiah entailed. You see, what Mark has given us is a very realistic look at Jesus' ministry. Because at the time when Jesus emerged and walked about the seas of Galilee and into the villages preaching and teaching, he was not the only one doing that. There was nothing extra special about Jesus' miracles and so on. Let's not fool ourselves. There were many miracle workers. And many of them came from Galilee where Jesus came from. And so there was nothing really in Mark's opinion to distinguish him really from others. For St. Mark, Mark's gospel is written from the perspective of the messianic secret. Jesus is only recognized as the Messiah through the one thing that no one else has ever done and will ever do. Through his passion, his death, and his resurrection. And so that is the only time that Mark sees him as truly the Messiah. And so when Peter says he is the Messiah, Peter sees him as the Messiah because the movement is going good, we're doing these miracles, and we're collecting some good change. And that's why Jesus tells him, Peter, you do not understand. Get behind me. Because you are setting your mind on earthly things and not on divine things. Peter was caught up with the movement. Peter was caught up with how good things were going and said, man, you're the boss. I think it's Machel Montano had a song, you're doing it like a boss. You people wouldn't know that. Sorry, only the younger ones. Sorry. For Peter, Jesus was doing it like a boss. And so that is how he saw him as Messiah. That's why he could say it. But then later on in the text, we realize he truly didn't understand who Jesus was. That's a very poignant message for us today. Who do we really say that Jesus is? And I'll use that word say within a modern context. Who do we think of him as? And who do we proclaim him as? Who do we say he is? James gives us a little glimpse into the early church of who they thought he was. And the early church, obviously, many members saw Jesus as an elitist. He would only mix with a certain type and not another type. And so James said, you know, two people come into your church. One is dressed all nice and everything, and you put him up at the front. And then another fella comes in, and he doesn't have anything that looks too pretty. He probably carries a type of fragrance that is not sold in the market. And we want to put him out. And James is saying, that is not who Jesus was. So we're proclaiming ourselves as Christians, but we're not living like Christ lived. When Jesus traveled the seas of Galilee and into the various villages in Judea, Jesus mixed with people on every level. And that's why so many followed him, because all of a sudden, people who were outcasts, the lepers who nobody wanted to touch, the lepers who had to walk with a bell ringing it saying unclean so that people will know not to go near to them, these are the people that Jesus interacted with. The prostitutes on the street that people had already condemned. The Syrophoenician woman whom they called a Gentile and could never make it into the kingdom of God. These are the people that Jesus reached out to. These are the people he touched. And James was saying, but this is not what we're reflecting in this church. That's not what is happening amongst us. And perhaps we can ask ourselves today, as a body, who do we say that Jesus is? And even as I look around the church still bears the scars of an era past when we were not too different from the community of James. We're not too different. And a lot of these things are done innocently. But it is only on hindsight we recognize the damage that would have been done by them. There was a time in this church, and when I say this church, I mean in the Anglican Church in Barbados in general, when there was something called pure rent. The church raised funds from renting pews. Those numbers you see there, those were to denote the pews. And families would have rented pews. And whether they were at church or not, don't sit in that pew. No one else could sit there. And we know who can afford to rent pews. Not everyone could afford to rent a pew. And so even in that act, we were dividing the church. Even in that act, we were separating persons simply based on their economic status or their class, or in the era gone, their color. Thank God that era is past. But we still have to ask ourselves, who do we say that Jesus is? How do we treat to each other within this body, this little body that we have here? Do we see ourselves as equal? Do we see all persons as equal in the sight of God, as children of God? Or is there somewhere in the back of our minds that still tell us, you are not as good as? I don't really want to be in this with you. You can stay over there. I know where you came from. I know who your family are, and can't be no better. You know how we say it from time to time. This morning's reading are really causing us to search into the belly of our church. To go deep within and ask ourselves if we are reflections of Christ. Who do we think Christ is? I've often said it, and I still hold true to it, that I believe if Christ were to come back into his world now, a lot of churches will close because they wouldn't recognize him. He can't go into a lot of churches in this world. Not him. Not a man who doesn't even know who his real father is. Not a man who walks around in clothes like he does. Not a man who has no status in society. Foxes have holes and birds of the air have nests, but the Son of Man has not where to lay his head. Are you coming in here? There's no space for that. You can't even give tithes. You know, there are some churches in our world, and even in this Barbados, where persons have to write down their salary. And I understand there was one church that if you gave a check that wasn't commensurate with the salary you received, it was posted on the bulletin board in Barbados. Who do they say that Christ is? And this is something that Christianity worldwide has to examine itself with. Who do we say this Christ really is? There are many persons who are still outcasts in our church, in our society. There's still a taboo surrounding mental illness in Barbados. If a person who is mentally ill comes to church and they keep a little noise or something, they're disturbing the peace. We don't want them around us. These are all things we have to ask ourselves about. Well, what are we really doing? What are we really saying about this Christ? For we may very well find ourselves like Peter, proclaiming, "You are the Messiah, the Son of God," but finding ourselves being rebuked at the end. And this is something Jesus spoke about. And I go back to Matthew 25. If you remember no other passage in Holy Scripture, remember Matthew 25. On that day, the master of the house will come and he will separate the sheep from the goats. He placed the sheep on his right and the goats on his left. And to those on his right, he will say, "I was hungry and you gave me food. I was thirsty and you gave me drink." And they will say, "Lord, when did we see you like that and do these things?" And he'll say, "As much as you did it to the least of one of these, you've done it to me." But then there's another set. The ones on his left, he'll say, "I was hungry and you did not feed me. I was thirsty and you gave me nothing to drink. I was naked and you didn't even clothe me. I was in prison, you didn't even come to look for me. I was sick and you didn't care for me. I was a stranger and you didn't welcome me." And we're told that many will say, "But Lord, when did we see you like this and didn't do these things? You know how we go. If I had seen you, I'd fix you up." And Jesus said, "Inasmuch as you haven't done it to the least of one of these, your brothers or sisters, you haven't done it to me." What Jesus was really saying in that passage is what church ought to be and what the Christian ought to be. Every human being in this world is a child of God, worthy of being embraced, worthy of being loved, worthy of the salvation that was won for us all on the cross. And that is why Jesus pointed to the cross. "If anyone would come after me, let him deny himself, Put away all the little things that you've piled upon yourself that you've used to say, I am so good. Abase yourselves. Take up the cross and follow me. During the Good Friday service, there's a wonderful meditation on the cross. And a part of it says, oh my people, my church, in what way have I offended you? What have I done to you? And then it goes on to say, I gave you the Holy Spirit to guide you, but you closed your heart to the counselor. I prayed that we may be one as the Father and I are one, but you quarrel and divide. I asked you to bring forth fruit, but you cast lots for my clothing. And the church is still doing those things today. And so the question lies before us all, as individuals and as a body. Who do you say that I am? Who do we really say that Jesus is? And don't think that by blurting out, you are the Messiah, the Son of God, all is well. Because Mark shows us that there are many who can say that. But when you examine how they see him as this Messiah, it bears nothing to the reality of who Jesus really is. It goes back to the passage I quoted last week from St. Matthew's Gospel, chapter 7 and verse 21. Not everyone who says, Lord, Lord, will be fit for the kingdom, but he who does the will of my Father. This is what James was drumming home to his church as well. That we are called to love each other. We are called to respect each other. Love each other not because we're all good, but love each other because we're all in need of some help. We're all in need of some help. And the sooner we recognize that, the better off we are. As soon as we start dividing and saying, this is a little better than that, and this sin is not as bad as that one, so if you commit that one, you stay outside. If you commit this one, you could come up to communion. It's no big thing. That's the past. The sacrament is between Christ and the individual. And that's why every Sunday in church we are challenged in a very special way. Every service is a challenge. First, if you're offering your gift at the altar, and there, remember that your brother or sister has something against you, what should you do? Leave your gift before the altar and go. First be reconciled to your brother, and then come and offer your gift. And then, if we say we have no, we deceive our, and the truth is not. But if we confess our, God is and will forgive our sins and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. Every Sunday, every time we celebrate the Mass, communion with God, reconciliation, communion with each other. If you can't do that, you're really telling Christ, I'm not ready for you yet. I'm not ready for you yet. And if we are not ready for him now, what did he say? In time to come, he will say to us, depart from me, for I never knew you. If you reject me now, I will reject you in time to come. And so let us all reflect. That question at Caesarea Philippi is being asked of each one of us today. Who do you say that I am? Who do you think Jesus is? What do you say about him in your daily life? Who do you say I am? Let us pray. Almighty and ever-living God, we give you thanks for the gift of your holy word, for sending your only begotten Son into this world to guide us back to you, to guide us to you by the way of the cross, by the way of humility, by the way of self-denial. Grant that we may so deny ourselves in this world and hold firm to your everlasting truths, that we may experience eternity in your nearer presence, in the bliss and beauty of your heavenly kingdom. And grant, Lord, that what we say with our lips we may believe in our hearts, and what we believe in our hearts we may show forth in our lives daily, for your name's sake. Amen.